Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is March 15th, 2017. This is our Wednesday night Lenten service. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Welcome to our midweek Lenten service for today as we continue to look at important words of our faith. We covered grace. Last week we covered what we mean by the word. And this evening we look at law and gospel, which is another one of those phrases we hear a lot about, especially Reformation time. Also throughout the year, but oftentimes they are said just assuming everybody knows what it's meant when people aren't always sure about what the terms are. The hymn board to my right, the three hymns are correct, the numbers. The hymn board to my left, the last two hymns are correct. So pay attention to the right board for the opening hymn, to my left for the last two, and of course I'll announce ahead of time. Also, as you came in, I hope you picked up the sheet that was back there. This evening, instead of giving you a sheet to fill in and so forth, I just Xerox this handy thing I give to my confirmands all the time so that they can remember law and gospel quite easily themselves. Before we begin, also just to update you, as some of you know, Friday I had an EMG and an x-ray. The EMG shows that I have some kind of nerve damage being caused by something in my lower back. So Monday I'm having an MRI, and Wednesday I go see a neurosurgeon. So that is where that stands. And I hate MRIs, so please pray for me. I'm not going to go through the thing, beat it up before the test is over. Unless I'm able to get something from my doctor that calms me down. This evening we begin with the order of confession and forgiveness on page 94. Those who came with a difficulty to stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ, was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You may be seated as we sing In the Cross of Christ, I Glory, hymn number 324, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 324.
That is in the waters under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for
I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and the fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You should not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God has given you. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor, you shall not covet your neighbor's house, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. Now when all the people saw the thunder, and the flashes of lightning, and the sound of the trumpet, and the mountain smoking, the people were afraid and trembled, and they stood far off and said to Moses, "You speak to us, and we will listen. But do not let God speak to us, lest we die." Moses said to the people, "Do not fear, for God has come to test you, that the fear of him may be before you, that you may not sin." The people stood far off, while Moses drew near to the thick darkness where God was. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading of the Holy Gospel according to St. John, the third chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus says, "And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world, that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. We will now sing hymn number 717, "Let Justice Flow," in the back of our worship. It's hymn number 717.
Jewish community, they just have the Old Testament and they don't call it the Old Testament.
For them, that's their Holy Scripture, what we call the Old Testament. It's the law and the prophets and the books of wisdom. But for us, we divide the Bible, of course, into the Old Testament or Old Covenant, New Testament, New Covenant. Well, just like that's divided, we have these two main teachings of law and gospel. There are two doctrines that stand out in the Bible like two big mountains. Mount Sinai, where Moses received the Ten Commandments, and then that hill called Calvary, or Golgotha. One old gospel tune is, I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary. So we refer to Calvary in this instance as a mountain as well. So on Mount Sinai, you have the law, Exodus 20. On the Calvary, you have the gospel. So simply put, the law represents the demands of God, what he expects of us, how he expects us to live if we are going to try to live a life by the law instead of by grace. And the gospel is the promise of God. So you have the demands of God versus the promise of God. We encounter God's word both as law and gospel, and we need to hear both. Some Christians have a misconception that being a Christian, especially if you grew up in the church like many of us did, and were never out of the church, that all we need to hear is the gospel, that we don't need to hear the law. But even so, being raised up in the church as an infant to an adult, we still need to be reminded of the importance of the law and why the law is needed to still be proclaimed. Now, on the other hand, we don't want to become like some churches where they speak so much law, you wonder if they even know what the gospel is. As I have mentioned before, I think I just mentioned it this past Sunday in the sermon, growing up in Kentucky, surrounded by fundamentalist churches, you heard an awful lot of law over the radio at night when Sunday night was dominated by these fundamentalist churches. And all you would hear is about what you shouldn't do, shouldn't do, shouldn't do. And now, if you did this or that, you were going to go to hell. It seemed like anything, some of these preachers, the way they got fired up and going, that anything you did outside of breathing was going to cause you to go to hell. And it was like, where's the gospel? When I was serving in Northern Kentucky in Florence, and hopefully from church, we started a coalition for mission in Eastern Kentucky. And this was an attempt to begin Lutheran churches in Eastern Kentucky, where at that time the closest church to Eastern Kentucky was Richmond. That's as far east as a Lutheran church had gone in Kentucky. And what we discovered was, and the reason we felt motivated to try to plant Lutheran churches in Eastern Kentucky, is that so many churches in Eastern Kentucky were these law preaching churches, these, what I refer to as offshoots of old New English Puritanism, where everything was you came, you came. And what we discovered when we went into Eastern Kentucky was there were an awful lot of men who believe in God. And there's an awful lot of men who believe in Jesus Christ. But they, because of the demands that their church made, they felt like they could not uphold those, and so they wouldn't go to church. They didn't hear anything about grace. And a lot of these men spent, from Monday through Friday or even Monday through Saturday, deep down in the bowels of the earth. They come up each day after being down in that mine for all those hours and breathing all that coal dust and so forth. And Friday came, they would want to let loose. Somebody break out a mason jar or grandpa's finest that made, and then somebody bring a banjo, and somebody a guitar too, and somebody a fiddle, harmonica, a washboard, and they'd start picking and playing and passing the moonshine around. And of course, if they'd gone to church then we'd go to church on Sunday morning, they'd hear all about the evils of drinking and the evils of smoking and the evils of chewing and the evils of dancing and the evils of do doing frivolous things, and so these men felt like they couldn't go to church, even though they believed. And they were amazed when we came in emphasizing not the laws so much, but the gospel of grace. That salvation is by grace through faith, apart from works of the law. And that was attractive to many of these men because they had not heard that before. They had just heard about how terrible they were, how unfit they were for the kingdom. But they would never hear the gospel. The law has to be preached. But once a person realizes they're a sinner, then the gospel needs to be preached so they know there's hope. So they know there is a way to salvation, and we say, well, have to abide by a bunch of rules and regulations. And so the difference between law and gospel is major, but both are necessary in the preaching and teaching of the church. The law tells us what to do. It convicts us of our sin. It's preached to the unrepentant sinner. It serves as a guide for the penitent believer. It shows us why we need a Savior. As my Old Testament professor liked to oftentimes say, the law is like a mirror for us. We look in the mirror and we see what we're really like. We look in the mirror and we see that blotch on our cheek, or we see that new pimple that's broken out, or we see that first gray hair that's in our head. We know we're not perfect anymore like we thought we were before we looked in the mirror. But we look at the law, we realize, even though we go to church, even though we say our prayers, even though we go to Sunday school, even though we do Bible studies, even though I go to weekend retreats and all that, we still can't save ourselves. And so the law is there for us to be that mirror to remind us before we get too self-confident. There's a danger in Christianity of Christians becoming like the Pharisees of Jesus' day, of becoming too self-righteous, thinking we're a better Christian than somebody else because all these things we know, all these things we do, all these things we support. That's not what's important. It's what is in our heart and our relationship toward God through that faith in Jesus Christ. The gospel tells us what God has done through Jesus Christ and what God continues to do. The gospel saves us. The gospel is preached to the troubled sinner who is looking for a way to be saved and a way of salvation. And the gospel creates in us a living faith. Going back to your days of confirmation and the explanation to the third article of the Creed, I believe that the Holy Spirit calls me through the gospel, enlighten me with his gifts, sanctifies and keeps me in the true faith the same way it calls, gathers, and enlightens the whole Christian church on earth. So that is the gospel. It creates a living faith in us that continues to grow each day. Another simple way to remember the difference between law and gospel, and you'll see on the sheet I gave you, is the old shipping distress signal SOS. Law shows our sin. Gospel shows our Savior. That's the simplest way to remember the difference between law and gospel. SOS. Law shows our sin. Gospel shows our Savior. And so they're both important. God reveals himself to us both in law and gospel. And both law and gospel appear in the books of the Old and New Testament. Again, a mistake sometimes Christians make is believing that all the laws in the Old Testament and all the gospels in the New Testament. Speaking of the book of Genesis, Martin Luther said that Genesis should be as well thought of and treasured as the four gospels, because there is as much gospel in the book of Genesis as in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So don't think that you cannot find any gospel in the Old Testament, nor that you won't find any law in the New Testament. And at the end of this evening, I'm going to challenger of naming, I'm going to give you some passages and some statements about Christianity, and you have to tell me whether they're law or gospel. We'll see how well you distinguish the two, between the two of them. Other duties of the law are to command us to good works of thought, word, and deed, to the unsaved, condemns and punishes sin, and readies one's heart to receive the gospel. Dr. Phil Williams, a Lutheran theologian, says, quote, "The law is the light that reveals the dirty room, or reveals how dirty the room is, not the broom that sweeps it clean." So the law is the light that shows us how dirty the soul is. It's not the broom that sweeps it clean. That's the gospel that sweeps it clean. Other duties of the gospel are it tells us the good news of our salvation in Jesus Christ. It gives forgiveness. It gives us faith. It gives us life. It gives us power to please God with good works as a response to His love, not as a burden or requirement to try to earn His love. It comforts us and it frees us from the condemnation of the law. Without the law, though, we do not realize the need for the gospel. Without the gospel, the law can only kill, because we can't fulfill the law. So if you can't fulfill the law, then when you stand before God on judgment day, there's only one verdict, and that's guilty, because you haven't met all the details of what the law was all about. So without the law, we don't realize the need for the gospel. Without the gospel, we can only suffer condemnation under the law. God uses the law in two ways: keep good order in creation, and to drive sinful human beings to depend on God alone, not trying to save themselves. See, there is no not guilty verdict under the law. It's only guilty. And this is what, as you've heard me say many times, separates Christianity from the religions of the world. The religions of the world are based on fulfilling laws to please the God that they worship, hoping to do enough good things to bargain their way into heaven or earn their way into heaven. Christianity comes along and says, no, that's not how it works. God has done it all. God has done it through the sending of His Son, and therefore we do not have to try and fulfill it. This is the point we see during the Sermon on the Mount, when those who were self-righteous thought that they could stand before God and say, well, God, I never broke any of the Ten Commandments, therefore I am justified, because I've never worshiped anybody but you, I've never used your name in vain, I always remember to go to the synagogue and the temple on the Sabbath, I honor my parents and those in authority, I haven't murdered anybody, I haven't committed adultery with anybody, I haven't stolen anything, I haven't borne false witness against anybody, I haven't coveted anything of my neighbors. That is actual physical action, is what they were taught. But what does Jesus do? He comes along and blows totally out of the water that kind of thing. Because He tells us, if you hate somebody in your heart, you've killed them. That hatred is violating that fifth commandment. If you looked at, of course, He was speaking evidently to a crowd, but only of men, or at least a Pharisee group of men, saying, if you look at another woman with lust in your heart, you've committed adultery. Even though you never touched her, even though you never tried to flirt with her or anything, just the fact that you looked at her and lusted, and of course, nowadays we say that women likewise. You're looking at some, you're married and you're looking at someone that's not your spouse, but blessed, you've broken the commandment. And I don't know how really any Pharisee could have said they didn't break the ninth or tenth commandment, because it just seems like no matter how hard we try to be satisfied with life or how much we thank God for the life we have. Seems like there's always some our neighbor has that we wish we could have. Whether it's a newer car or a fancier house, or they've got a vacation place down on the lake or down in Florida or California or wherever. I think everybody at least once in their life covets. You know, you're in elementary school, you want the, depending on whether you're a girl or a boy, you know, you want the dress like so-and-so has, or your boy, you want cool tennis shoes like so-and-so has. But this is the point was, we don't have to actually do the act. All we have to do is have the thought, and we violate the law. So how do you make up for that? What can you do to make up for that? Nothing. Because as soon as you're trying to do something to make up for that, you're committing some other kind of sin of thought or committing the sin of commission or omission. And as we're taught, sins of omission are just as bad as sins of commission. When you don't do something you know you should have done, that's as bad a sin as doing something you shouldn't have done. And so the law actually is a gift from God because it shows us clearly that we cannot be right with Him by our own efforts, but that we must have a Savior. So God uses or gives us the gospel. And if you know no other verse, you should know John 3:16, as it is commonly referred to. It is the gospel in a nutshell. It explained it all. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, so that whoever believes in Him will not perish, but have everlasting. That's the only verse you need to know if you're trying to witness to someone. God loved you so much. No matter how bad you feel, no matter how bad you feel about yourself, how terrible you think you are, God loved you so much He sent His only Son to suffer and die on the cross to pay the debt of sin that you owe, so that you, relying on and believing in and trusting in and having confidence in and throwing yourself upon the blood of Christ shed on the cross for your sin, you have forgiveness, and forgiveness brings salvation, and salvation brings everlasting life. And so, remember John 3:16. And if you can only remember a second verse, this may surprise some of you. The second verse you should know and be able to share with someone looking for salvation is John 19, verse 30. For those of you who are biblical scholars, you will recognize John 19 is John's crucifixion account of Jesus. And the 30th verse takes place after Jesus says, "I thirst." And a soldier put a sponge on that branch of hyssop and held it to his lips. And then in verse 30, it tells us after the sponge is taken away, Jesus said, "It is finished." Not I am finished. It is finished. The word also is translated as accomplished, completed. It is the Greek word tetelestai, from which we derive words like telephone, telegraph, television, telecommunications, something that describes, something that projects voice or communication across the distance. When Jesus was saying it is finished, He was saying He had completed God's plan of salvation for all time to come until He returns in glory. Traditionally, tetelestai was the cry of the victor in a race. As he crossed the finish line, he would throw his arms in the air and he'd shout, "Tetelestai! I have finished. I have completed. I have accomplished this race first." The reason I say that's a second verse you should remember is because Jesus is saying that by fulfilling John 3:16, he completed all that God sent him here to do. He won for us that salvation. He won for us that place in the kingdom of heaven. He won for us that eternal home, where as St. John tells us in that 21st chapter of the book of Revelation, there is no more death, no more grief, no more crying, and no more pain. For the old order of things have passed away. And so John 3:16, the gospel in a nutshell, John 19:30, it is finished. It is finished, showing that God had completed everything that Jesus was supposed to do. And Jesus and our Heavenly Father continue to work for us. As St. Peter tells us in chapter 1 of 1 Peter verse 5, he tells us, who by God's power, talking about us who believe, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. St. Peter's telling us that God is guarding our faith and our salvation so that nothing happens to us. That word guarded means to keep an eye on something. It means to post a guard. It means to have a garrison or a brigade of troops guarding something that is important to prevent the enemy from taking it or stealing that position. So God has put our salvation, his eye keeps his eye on it, and guards it so that we are numbered among those elect when Jesus comes again in glory. So grace comes through the gospel, which tells us that we do not have to fulfill the law for salvation, but that we rely on Jesus, who has fulfilled it for us. So with that in mind, let's see how well you can distinguish law and gospel. Ezekiel 18, verse 4. Listen carefully. The soul who sins is the one who will die. Is that law or gospel? The soul who sins is the one who will die. Law. That is law. Luke 19:10. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost. Gospel. Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Is Paul's using this as evidence of why we must trust in Jesus Christ, because we all sin and fall short of the glory of God, which falls short of the fulfillment of the law. So that is an example of the law being in the New Testament. This one's too easy. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. That is, of course, gospel. Job 19:25-27. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I and not another. Gospel. Here's an example of gospel being in the Old Testament. I know that my Redeemer lives. He will stand on the earth. After my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. Okay, now these are several statements talking about law or gospel and how they're used. It's used by the Holy Spirit to show us our sins and move us to be sorry because of it. Law or gospel? Law. Law is used by the Holy Spirit to show our sins and move us to be sorry because of it. Provides the power for living the Christian life. Law or gospel? Provides the power for living the Christian life. Gospel. Yeah, power for living the Christian life. Yeah, gospel. To know what the Christian life is. series of commands of do's and don'ts. That's like John 3:16. Our gospel includes only promises and words of comfort. Gospel. Our gospel should be shared with those who know their sin and struggle under their burden. Our gospel should be shared with those who know their sin, recognize their sinfulness, and are struggling under that burden of sin. Recognize their sin. It's like the Philippian jailer. What does that do to be saved? They don't know. All right. Next week, we will examine worship in a biblical sense, not in a modern sense. Not worship as entertainment. Not worship as wanting your church to look like a big theater, having theater seats with cup holders so you can drink your 32-ounce Slurpee or your giant Safeway cup of coffee. You know, what does the Bible mean by worship? What is the purpose of God's community coming together and to worship Him? What is should be the feeling? What should be the purpose? What should be taking place? So that will be next week. If I could have 2 volunteers for the offering, and then we will have the prayers, the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. The Lenten journey leads us to repentance and new life. Let us turn our hearts to God, who is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Our response tonight is, Lord, have mercy. Let us pray for all who lead and teach in the church, that they would guide God's people daily to live more fully into their baptismal inheritance. We pray, Lord, have mercy. Let us pray for the world, that those who live in the land sacred to Abraham's descendants may renew their commitment to work for peace and establish security at last for their people. We pray, Lord, have mercy. Let us pray for the unemployed and the underemployed, for the homeless and those without adequate housing, that Christ's healing presence restore their dignity and erase the fears of insecurity. We pray, Lord, have mercy. Let us pray for all who seek to enter the community of faith through baptism at Easter, that their Lenten journeys be filled with the blessings promised in Abraham. We pray, Lord, have mercy. Let us pray for those who are ill or hospitalized, that they may be restored to a life of wholeness. We pray, Lord, have mercy. Let us give thanks for all the saints and all the faithful departed, who live in the glory with Christ forever, asking that at length we may join them. We pray, Lord, have mercy. Merciful and gracious God, hear our prayers, restore us to the joy of your salvation, and uphold us with your Holy Spirit, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless, comfort, strengthen, and keep us, now and forever. Amen. We conclude this evening with Blessed Assurance, hymn number 638, and thank you, worship, hymn number 638.
This concludes our Wednesday night Lenten service. Join us Sunday at 8 or 10:30 for our Sunday services. Next Wednesday again at 7 o'clock. There's also a light supper from 5:30 to 6:30 on Wednesday evenings prior to the service. St. John's has a food pantry open every Wednesday 9 to 10:45. Outreach store Monday through Friday, closed on Thursday from 9:30 to 1. Every Friday from noon to 1, there is the Rainbow Table. Everyone is welcome to share a meal. Again, thank you for joining us for our Wednesday night Lenten service.